Workman Publishing and Workman Audio present How Magicians Think, Misdirection, Deception, and Why Magic Matters by Joshua J. Read by the author. The door to magic is closed, but it's not locked. Jack Devlin, magician. Introduction. I spend 300 days a year on the road, performing magic. I spend a lot of time on the other side of the stage, too, watching magicians. One night, I was in the audience for a performance by Jan Frisch. His act looks like nothing you've ever seen. A little red ball torments Jan by disappearing and appearing where it's least expected, driving him mad. At one point, it even leaps off the table and hits him in the forehead. And though the show is as funny as it is skillful, what happened at the end of his act that night was something nobody in the audience will ever forget. I had seen Jan's act a dozen times and knew all my favorite moments by heart, but when he finished his act that night, Jan bowed for applause and a thick stream of water poured down from the top of the stage, soaking him and his signature white t-shirt. As the water drenched him, he extended his empty hand into the spray and a bright red ball appeared. Blackout. That wasn't how the act was supposed to end, but the previous act in the show used water. And this was Jan's way of winking at the audience to let them know that he'd been watching the show too. He adapted his magic to the venue, scrambling the audience's expectations while pulling off the perfect trick for that evening. As a magician watching a magician, I'm looking for two things: seamlessness and context. Seamlessness means that the illusion is airtight, that the magic flows naturally. If the technique is poor or the material choice is ugly, there's no illusion. So the first step for any magician is to attain fluidity, to become seamless. The other thing I'm looking for is context. Suppose I borrow a dollar from a child and change it into a $100 bill and then give it back to her. There is context, since I'm using money that belongs to someone else. There's a storyline, causing money to multiply, and there's an emotional hook, since I give her back something far more valuable than what she gave me. The magic money feels real to the child because she can touch and remember it and spend it. My hope is that after reading How Magicians Think, you'll watch magic shows differently, not less critically, but in a more enlightened way. Too many of us watch magic shows to figure out how the tricks are done. As you'll learn, that mindset is a trap. While you're busy trying to find the solution to an illusion, you miss what is in plain sight: artistry. You miss the staging of the illusion, the carefully considered script, and a perfectly timed observation that distracts your mind or makes you laugh. You ignore the aesthetics of the show, the grace with which the objects appear and disappear, and the way the lighting, the costumes, and the props are thematically linked. You fail to grasp the metaphor of what the magician is doing and the interplay between their work and what's going on in the world around them. Magic tricks aren't puzzles, but most of us see them that way. At its very best, magic reminds us of the thrill of the unknown. Many of the performing arts can take our breath away, but only magic makes you question whether you saw what you just saw. Most other performing arts are about understanding and experience. Magic puts front and center what we don't understand, so we can marvel at the mystery. People often conflate being fooled with feeling foolish. I want to help people see that although being fooled is magic's baseline for success, it can be, and ought to be, much more. Magicians do things beyond our comprehension. When done well, those things should instill in us a unique cocktail of feelings that no other performing art can deliver: escape, awe, and, in the best cases, pure wonder. I would further argue that there is a place where we can appreciate magic without knowing how it works. This book is a roadmap to that place. You'll still be fooled by the magician, but you'll notice and appreciate her choices. Magic shows make for great stories, but the better stories are about the formation of illusions, the characters who create them, and the psychology behind the tricks. Houdini observed, "Many things that seem wonderful to most men are the everyday commonplaces of my business." I'll share some of the remarkable ideas and people who are changing the way we think about magic and even the world. The performance of magic is necessarily shrouded in secrecy. Most magic performances are elusive by design. You get glimpses of a magician's interests and origins, but only enough to serve the illusion. My show, and the shows of my colleagues, are meant to make you perk up and ask, where did that go? How did he do that? Can I see that again? Secrecy breeds curiosity. People want to know. They want the gaps filled in. Each of the 52 essays that follow is set up as an answer to one of the many questions I'm asked after shows by people who are fascinated with magic. The questions vary, but they tend to come from the same core curiosity. People are trying to better understand the power of magic beyond a particular trick. And because I've dedicated my life to creating and performing magic, they think perhaps I might have some insight to offer. Each essay stands alone, so feel free to skip around to what interests you most. I hope that, taken together, they'll give you a deeper appreciation for how magicians think. I wrote this book on tour in the days and hours between shows. These words brought me face to face with my subject every night, an endless supply of the ups and downs experienced by a performer in the trenches. The secrets shared here can't be found in YouTube tutorials or Google searches. They are psychological in nature, developed over centuries of deceiving the public. My answers are part essay, part memoir, and with one exception, I reveal everything but how the tricks are done. I've been careful not to reveal too many of the actual secrets to magic tricks, yet still some magicians will inevitably be upset about the concepts I explore in these pages. But if I deepen your interest and respect for the art of magic even a little, it's worth bending the rules. Showtime. 1. Why Magic? Part 1. Any life is made up of a single moment, the moment in which a man finds out once and for all who he is. Jorge Luis Borges, writer, poet. Werner Reich, a 91-year-old Holocaust survivor, has a fascinating answer to why he does magic. Orphaned during the war, he endured two different concentration camps before being transferred to Auschwitz. His bunkmate there was a magician who showed Werner a simple trick along with its secret. The two used magic to assuage hostile guards. Werner remained a performing magician his entire life. He spoke to me about the importance of jokes and magic in the camps. They took us away from reality, he said. They engaged your imagination and moved you away from the dismal surroundings. It is there that I learned the true value of imagination. I asked the same question of magician Abby Lynn Albani. Abby was floating 10 feet above the stage, rehearsing an illusion with her husband, David Goldrake, when she unexpectedly fell to the stage floor and broke her neck. The fall also damaged her spinal cord. She was flown to Luxembourg and Germany for life-saving procedures and for a time used a wheelchair. After being told I would never breathe alone, walk, or move, I am now able to breathe without support, sit up, and stand, Abby said. I shared the stage with her at a magic conference in Las Vegas and watched from the wings as she recounted her harrowing accident, then rose out of her chair and walked across the stage. When I asked Abby what drew her back to magic, she recounted the anguish she still feels about her injury. Before the accident, she told me, going a day not performing would drive me insane. Now it's been almost 4 years, and I don't know if being on stage is even in the cards for me. I battle these thoughts every day. It honestly kills me to even think that I may never perform again. It's all I ever wanted in life. I asked David Copperfield this same question. He's worth just south of $1 billion, and yet he does more than 500 shows a year in Las Vegas. He owns his own private island in the Bahamas and a private jet to get there, yet almost never takes vacations. What draws him back to magic? An impulse to push the craft forward, it turns out. I'm trying to change theater in my own way, not just magic. I say that humbly because I'm learning every single day. I do 15 shows a week, and every single audience I have is like a test screening. Werner Reich used magic to momentarily escape Auschwitz. Abby Albani still feels a call back to the magic show stage, despite a trick almost ending her life. David Copperfield performs a backbreaking 15 shows a week in pursuit of perfecting new material. What do these magicians have in common? Nothing, except being uncontrollably drawn to magic. And that's the point. Critics paint magicians with the same broad brush, But magic means something different to every magician I interviewed for this book. And while each was powerfully attracted to magic, they all came to magic for a different reason. What's more, the reason someone gets into magic is almost never the reason they stay with it. Esteemed magic historian and mentalist Max Maven observed that we have to evolve beyond whatever got us into magic in the first place. Everyone goes through a magic phase, but loving magic comes from a place of wanting to figure out how.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.